Hello, welcome back to Learn Physics. Today, for class 12 students, we are starting the previous year question paper revision. Okay, so I thought, I know I didn't complete that electronics part, and now it is January. So all of you would have completed your second model exam also, isn't it? Your mock test would have happened. Second mock test also would have happened now. But now still if I'm continuing with the theory portion, it won't work out well for you. So I'll start the question paper, I thought, and in the comment box also some of the students has the same opinion, like we can start the revision. Okay, so I thought I'll start with the question papers. So you will be getting an idea about the question paper. And this is, in the new syllabus, that is this year's syllabus, some of the chapters are omitted already, isn't it? By this CBSE board itself, they omitted. And the rest of the questions, and we will be discussing with the previous year's question papers. Along with that, I'll be doing that sample paper question also. Sample paper question and answer is available. So everything, all these question papers and their answer keys are available in the net, but you should check thoroughly or you should try to solve that. Okay, so most of the children will be having the laziness to touch with the question paper. Okay, so that's why I thought, okay, at least you can hear whatever I am telling. Okay, so here this is 2018 question paper, set 1. Okay, so the first question in section A, a proton and an electron traveling along parallel paths enter a region of uniform magnetic field acting perpendicular to their paths. Which of them will move in a circular path with higher frequency? So proton and electron are traveling parallel to the path, parallel paths, and enter a region of uniform magnetic field. Magnetic field is acting perpendicular to it. Which of the following will move in a circular path with higher frequency? Which will be, see, the frequency of the charged particle is directly proportional to Q and inversely proportional to M. Okay, then here proton and electron. Okay, so their charges are same, so it depends only on the mass. Okay, so mass of proton will be as if mass of proton is 1.8 times mass of electron, isn't it? So which is having, so here it is asked which is having higher frequency. Higher frequency means which will be having higher frequency, less mass. Which is having less mass? Electron is having less mass. So the answer is electron. Okay, frequency is higher frequency. The question is to find out the higher, which is having higher frequency. Higher frequency will be having for the particle which is having less mass. Okay, here proton has more mass. Proton has more mass. So the electron will be having higher frequency. Okay, understood? The second one, name the electromagnetic radiation used for water purification. Water purification, which one we will be using? UV rays. UV radiations are used for, UV radiations are used for water purification, and IR radiation. Then next is eye surgery. Eye surgery, IR radiations will be using, laser will be using for eye surgery. Okay, next, draw graphs showing variation of photoelectric current with applied voltage for two incident radiations of equal frequency but different intensities. Intensities are different but they have equal frequency, same frequency and but different intensity. So we should draw the two graphs. So in those cases potential will be same, isn't it? So this one here we can applied voltage. This one applied voltage, this here it is photoelectrons, photoelectrons will be there. So here, see if it is having same frequency and different intensity. Okay, Here this is stopping potential. Stopping, if intensity is different also, stopping potential will remain the same, isn't it? For the frequency, depending on the frequency only, stopping potential will be vary. For different intensities, stopping potential remains the same, but intensity, number of electrons will be increasing as the photoelectrons will be increasing as the intensity increases. Okay, so clear, this is about the applied potential and the photoelectrons. Okay, then next is fourth one. Four nuclei of an element undergo fusion to form a heavier nucleus with the release of energy. Which of the two, the parent or daughter nucleus, would have higher binding energy per nucleon? So we know fusion and fission. While fusion is happening, binding energy per nucleon, how we will be representing that? See, binding energy per nucleon, binding energy per nucleon, how it will be represented? See, you are remembering, right? Here it is decreasing in this way. After that, from 30 to 170, it will remain almost the same. 30 to 170, this is the binding energy. This here it is mass number, and here it is binding energy per nucleon. So it will be, as it is fusion is happening, as the mass number increases, according to that binding energy per nucleon also increases. So which will be having more? See, helium, when it is protons, when it is converting to He2, helium means it will be converting, its binding energy is increasing. So which will be having higher binding energy, parent or daughter? Daughter will be having the higher binding energy. As mass number increases, binding energy per nucleon also will increase. Okay, so the next one is, which mode of propagation is used for short wave broadcast services? This is for the communication system. This year you don't have communication systems, right? So the fifth question not required for us. So next is section B, sixth one. Two electric bulbs P and Q have their resistances in the ratio 1:2. They are connected in series across a battery. Find the ratio of the power dissipation in these bulbs. So the bulbs are connected in series. Series connection, which will be keeping constant, current will be remaining same for all the bulbs, isn't it? So resistance of the bulbs are Rp is to, this is sixth one, Rp is to Rq is given as 1:2. It is connected in series. Ratio of powers, PP is to PQ, we should find out. Okay, so current remains the same. So we can take the formula for power, which includes current. Okay, so P equals, including current, I square R. So P by PQ equals I square into RP by I square into RQ. Okay, I will, same current will be flowing through the two resistors or two bulbs which are connected in series, since it is connected in series. So I and I will remain same. So Rp by Rq, that is 1:2. The answer is 1:2. Okay, so here understood. So the next is seventh one. A 10 volt cell of negligible internal resistance is connected in parallel across a battery of EMF 200 volt and internal resistance 38 ohm as shown in the diagram. Find the value of current in the circuit. So it is given like, see here it is. Here it is 38 ohm and this is 200 volt and it is 10 volt. Okay, so here we can apply the Kirchhoff's loop rule. We can apply, while we are applying the Kirchhoff's loop rule, A, B, C, D. If I am taking it like that, taking the loop A, B, C, D, A, C minus 200, A, B, C, D, A. So minus 200 plus 38 into I -10 that is equal to 0. So while we are solving this, we will get it as -198 + 38i = 0. Therefore, we can write it as i = 190/38 amps. Okay, this is the answer. Otherwise, in different methods you can adopt for this. See, here it is the effective EMF. Effective EMF will be, and that way also you can write down. See, effective EMF. EMF effective will be equal to, see, positive is connected to positive. So it is 200 - 10, that is 190, and resistance is 38 ohm. So you will get it as current as 190/38. In that manner also you can find out. In any one method you can adopt for this. Okay. So the next one is in 7th question itself, OR question. 7th OR question, okay. In a potentiometer arrangement, for determining the EMF of a cell, the balance point of the cell in open circuit is 350 cm. When a resistance of 9 ohm is used in external circuit of the cell, the balance point shifts to 300 cm. Determine the internal resistance of the cell. So here direct question it is, in an open circuit it is given as 350 cm, and in, while we are connecting 9 ohm resistance externally, the balancing point is 300 cm. You should find out the internal resistance. The same formula you are using for your experimental, this practically also, isn't it? So tell me, what is the formula for this one? R is equal to L1/L2 - 1 × R. Isn't it? So L1 here in an open circuit, how much it is? 350 / 300 - 1 × resistance, which is given as 9 ohm. 9 ohm. So here, sorry, 7/6 - 1 × 9. So here you will get it as 1/6 × 9. 6/6, 7 - 6 = 1, 1/6. So here you will get it as 3/2. 3/2 is 1.5 ohm. Okay, clear? So the next one is 8th one. Why are infrared waves often called heat waves? Because it can heat up the body or heat up the environment. If infrared rays are given, that object will be getting heated up. Okay, it can heat up the objects. That is why we are calling it as heat waves. What do you understand by the statement electromagnetic waves transport momentum? While it is moving, it has momentum. How we can say it will transport momentum? Because it is transferring the momentum. Because of this electromagnetic waves, we can make the object move. So transporting the momentum, how we can say that? It will give the charges in, it can make the charges in motion. Isn't it? Electromagnetic waves are giving means it will make the charges in motion. So a charge can move with the help of electromagnetic waves, means this electromagnetic wave is transporting momentum. It is transferring the momentum. So it can help the object to move. Okay. So the radiation pressure. Listen, it can give exert radiation pressure. How it can exert radiation pressure? Only if force is there, then only pressure will be there, right? Force, how the force will be producing? Because of the rate of change of momentum. Okay, so radiation pressure also gives an idea that electromagnetic waves will be producing. Radiations are coming, it will be giving a pressure. Okay, radiation pressure. While we are executing radiations, radiation pressure is forming, or it can make the charges move. Okay, so that is there. We can say that electromagnetic waves transport momentum. Okay, so it can make the charges move. Charges it can give, it can sustain the motion in charges. Okay, so and infrared waves are heat waves. I already told it can give the heat energy, that is it will make the particles in thermal motion. Okay, it can provide sufficient thermal motion to the particles. Okay, so they are called as heat waves. So next is 9th one. If light of wavelength 412.5 nanometer is incident on each of the metals given below, which one will show photoelectric emission and why? See, metals given as sodium, it is given as 1.92, then next is potassium 2.15, and calcium it is 3.20, then molybdenum it is 4.17. These are the work functions. It's nu zero, that is given as EV, and these are the metals. So which one will be, so the incident ray, the ray of light which is incidenting have a wavelength of 412.5 nanometer. Okay, so what will be the, what is work function? Work function is minimum energy required for the electron to come out. Okay, so this one, if this wavelength, how much is the energy we should calculate? Okay, more than that, if it is coming, this more than that, if this energy is more than the given work functions, then what will happen? This photoelectric effect will happen. Okay, so this is the minimum energy required for the electron to come out from the metal surface. Okay, minimum this much of energy is required. If the energy calculated from this is greater, okay, than this one, then we can say this will be, these many molecules will be giving photoelectric emission with this wavelength. So first we should find out what is the energy of this wavelength. E is equal to h nu, that is hc by lambda, by calculating 6.6 into 10 to the power minus 34 into 3 into 10 to the power 8 divided by lambda is 412.5 into 10 to the power minus 9 nanometer. Here it is everything in electron volt, right? So we can convert this in electron volt by dividing it to 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19. While you are solving, you will get it as, it's nearly equal to 3 point something you will get. Okay, 3 electron volt. Okay, so here it is having energy 3.20 also there. So we should calculate it fully. 3.01 electron volt we will be getting here. Okay, as the energy. So the given wavelength has an energy of 3.01 electron volt. But we have the work functions 1.92, 2.15, 3.20, 4.17. So which are having less work function than the given energy? Sodium has less, potassium has less. So these two will be giving photoelectric emission. If more work function is more, this is not sufficient. Okay, so these two will be, can have this photoelectric emission. Okay, clear? Next is 10th question. It's there in your, it's not there for your syllabus because it is about the carrier wave, that is communication systems which is coming. It's not required for you. Then 11th one. 11th one. First one, it's choices there. First question I'll discuss. 4 point charges. Capital Q, small q, capital Q and small q are placed at the corners of a square of side A as shown in the figure. Find the resultant electric force on a charge Q and the potential energy of the system. Okay, so here this is small q, capital Q, Q and Q. This is A. So we should find out the resultant force. So everything is positive, right? So here Q and Q, so in which direction is find the resultant force on charge Q, on Q. So if I am considering this Q, what will be the A, B, C, D? Okay, so resultant force on this C, see, because of this Q, force will be acting here. In which direction it will be, since it is positive, outwards. B and C, both are positive, so it will be acting outwards. Then one more, capital Q. It will be acting in this direction, isn't it? So this will be the direction due to, so force due to this one, B, force at B, this is force at due to D, this is force due to A. Okay, these are the forces acting. Okay, now here, what is F A? Is 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 capital Q square divided by, what is this distance? This is A and this is A. So it will be, see, 2 A square, root 2 A square, so root 2 into A. Root 2 into A the whole square. Okay, 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 Q1 Q2 by R square, that is F A. Then F due to A C, F A C, like that I will write. D C, this is BC. Okay, so next is FBC. FBC equals 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 capital Q small q divided by A square. FDC, that also will be 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 capital Q small q divided by distances A. Okay, A square. Okay, now we need to find out the resultant force. How we can find out the resultant? See, B and C, the resultant of these two forces, these are same forces, right? Isn't it? So what will be the effective force acting on this? Resultant. See, one vector is in this direction, another vector is in this direction. What will be the resultant? Parallelogram law of vectors. Resultant will be acting through this. So this will be the resultant vector for the given two vectors, these two vectors. Okay, so that resultant force will be acting along AC. FR equals, see, what is the resultant of these two? 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 QQ by R square A square. This one, what will be the resultant? Root of A square plus root 2 A square. Isn't it? If that same forces are acting, means root 2 A square. So it is root 2 A, 1 root 2 into 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 capital Q small q divided by A square. You understood, right, how we are getting? See, A and 2 are the same vectors. What is the formula to for vector addition? Resultant of two vectors, R is equal to root of A square plus B square plus 2 AB cos theta. Here it is, A and B are perpendicular to each other. So cos 90 is 0, this won't exist. So if A and B are same, A square plus A square. So we will get it as root 2 A square, that is root 2 A. So here, which is the vector magnitude of these two vectors? It is 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 QQ by A square. So we will get it like that. So the resultant force F will be equal to FR plus FAC. Okay, so this is equal to root 2 into 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 capital Q small q divided by A square plus 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 q square divided by root 2 A the whole square. Okay, so 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 is common, q divided by A square also common. So it, here it has root 2 q plus q by 2. Root 2 A the whole square is, okay, this is the resultant force acting. Then next we should find out the potential energy of the system. The same method you can adopt for finding the potential energy, 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 QQ by R. So clear? So there is an OR question, that one we will take it in the next class. So I hope it is clear for you, and if you like the channel, please don't forget to subscribe. Thank you for watching. Bye.